If you want to speak, we need you to sign in. Just tell us your name and address, and we'll call you in order, please. Anybody else wants to sign in, please? Anybody?
What are we signing for?
You want to speak?
You can do it right up here.
Get him, Robert.
Robert doesn't say where you're from, but I assume you're from Lawrenceville?
Lawrenceville.
Okay.
For the mention of bright colors, for all those who know me, I could not find a yellow suit. I tried. First, I want to personally thank you for your time, genuinely, seriously, and for putting this meeting together. I've got a lot of talking points. Some are in the form of questions. But since we've never met, I want to let you know who I am. I live in Lawrenceville. I've been in Georgia since 1981. I'm a very small business owner. I am a professional cycling coach. I started mycyclecoach.com 10 years ago. My number one concern is safety. I'm the past president of the largest cycling organization in the Southeast, and I've written published monthly cycling articles for the last 5 years. Obviously, I'm a cyclist, but I'm not just any cyclist. To date, I've ridden in excess of 150,000 miles in 16 years. With that many miles, I've seen it all, and I've done almost as much. I've been the victim of a hit and run. I've had crashes that were caused by other cyclists. I've had crashes that were my own fault. I've lost friends who were killed while riding their bike. 1 month ago, a driver pulled in front of us, locked up his brakes, and then pulled a Glock 9mm on us, all because we were riding on the right side of the road. Just 1 month ago, well, actually, that's what I just mentioned. 6 months after I was married, my wife and I were riding a bicycle, and next thing I know, I hear a blood-curdling scream. I literally turn around and I see my wife literally ragdolling through the air, all because a van, chose to buzz us when the oncoming lane was completely open and clear. Imagine me running up to my bride of 6 months and thinking that she's dead, sprawled out across the road. She had so much road rash on her face that she was unrecognizable. Miscalculating a tight turn up in North Georgia mountains in 2006 resulted in me going literally off the edge of the mountain at 45 miles an hour. And I was left with my left leg filleted open, profusely bleeding, and my right wrist completely bent back and every bone broken. And after several hours thinking I was going to be one of those 60 minutes or 2020 stories that you always hear. So I know what's at stake when I clip in. Therefore, understand that my comments are not based on rhetoric, they're not based on theory, they're not based on political agendas, but real life. Point number one, safety. All three of you have mentioned that safety is your concern. Mr. Hawkins, in an email comment that you gave this week, you said, and I quote, "I signed on to the bill because of my concern with the issue of safety." Respectfully, if that were the case, this town hall meeting should have been held, and many of them, I might add, to allow you to hear from cyclists in great numbers, long before House Bill 689 was ever even drafted, let alone being introduced into legislative session. But now here we are. Please explain to me and to every cyclist in this room why you believe that creating multiple groups of four, as Jim Walsh clearly visibly showed us tonight, riding in a single file, being separated by a minimum of 50 feet is creating a safe environment. And this is for any one of you to respond. Again, if safety is really your concern, please share with us how you voted for House Bill 101, which is better known as the 3-foot law, and explain to us in detail what you have done to further expose and advance the 3-foot law since it was signed into law July the 1st, 2011. Question: if you haven't done anything to literally help the advancement of this law, which clearly increases the safety for cyclists and would fulfill your stated concern for our safety, why would you ever expect me or any other cyclist in this room to believe that any other bill that is clearly not safe for cyclists would make any difference, would make any difference other than the 3-foot law? The majority of our state law enforcement doesn't even have a clue about the 3-foot law and therefore can't enforce it. How in the world would you get the police to enforce your bill? And before you answer, a cycling friend of mine was riding in Hall County last week. He was pulled over by a deputy. And after very forceful words from the Hall County deputy, the deputy actually backed down when my friend actually cited the law to the deputy. And he explaining him that he had the legal right to ride in whatever part of the lane he deemed safe for specific conditions. Oh, by the way, that deputy has received official counseling from his superiors. I can give you many more examples, but without the sake of time. Point number two, tag fees and registration. The following questions are for any of you. Number one, your bill does not distinguish between a $10,000 carbon road bicycle and a Target or Walmart $100 bicycle. Therefore, if I were a parent and bought a Walmart bicycle for my child, your bill would force me to register this bicycle for more than 10% of its actual cost. And if I did not, then you would fine me $100. We already know the answer to this question, but we want to give you the chance to share your perspective on number one, how would this affect future bicycle purchases for these institutions? And number two, how would you explain to the retailers as this being good business? Not to mention the loss of revenue, which is ultimately tax dollars. Since your bill has explicit requirement to provide a valid civic address during the registration process, how would you make it possible for homeless people to comply with the law unless the state of Georgia provide them with free housing within 30 days of becoming homeless, which is not provided for your bill? I could specifically describe to you countless crashes of cyclists where part of their physical injuries were actually caused by coming into contact with parts of their bicycle. But for the sake of time, I won't. With your bill, all bicycles would have a tag, and I quote from your bill, at least 4 inches wide and not less than 7 inches in length. And my guess it would be the same material used as our vehicle tags. Back to your stated concerns of cyclist safety, why would you introduce a bill requiring a metal type object to be required to be mounted on a bicycle and therefore become a real and legitimate object that could cause serious physical injury and in a worst case scenario potentially cut a main artery in a crash and become fatal? Is this what the state is really ready to handle for the type of lawsuits that is almost assuredly to come? There's countless charity events that collect broken and unused bicycles and refurbish them and give them to underprivileged children. Do you expect a charity to go and register each bicycle, pay a registration fee or a transfer fee, mount tags to each one, distribute them to the deserving children, and then who in the world is going to propose to keep track of each bicycle so that the registration fees are renewed every 5 years? What are you proposing would be a potential literally shutdown for incredible organizations that are trying to make a positive influence in children's lives? What possibly would you say to them to justify your bill? And then finally, the right to assemble. Your bill states, and I quote, when a roadway is part of the state highway system, the Department of Transportation may restrict persons from riding bicycles on the roadway or designate certain times when bicycle riding is permissible. And it's the same for the local. Everyone in this room knows exactly what this means and opens up the door to our government telling us where and when we can and cannot ride our bicycles. Forget that every other absurd component of this bill. This verbiage telling us when and where we can ride our bicycles is a direct violation of free society. I promise you that the cycling community will not sit back and let this happen. Last time I checked, the state of Georgia is in the United States. And if my history is correct, we're in a free society. Our government is here to provide its citizens protection from all enemies, foreign and domestic, and to uphold the Constitution. Yes. You are not in the bicycle recreation business. Every cyclist in this room and across this state will make sure that that does not happen. There's charity rides that are from March to October, almost every weekend in this state. Many of them are staged in and around small towns, provide tremendous revenue to local businesses. I've even started my own event on behalf of a rare disease that my wife has. In my experience, living my entire life in this country, anytime the government, whether local, federal, or state, is given the ability to institute restrictions or limitations on its citizens, it has always done so, and even more than anticipated. And if Mr. Siphon is present, those whose name seems to come up every time there's serious complaining about cyclists in Hall County, I would ask you to share with us, cyclists, the specific details behind your recent statement to the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, and I quote, "I can't tell you the times I've just about had to hit the ditch because of a cyclist." Every cyclist here is waiting with bated breath to hear how someone riding on a bicycle that weighs approximately 17 pounds, wearing only spandex clothing and a helmet, without the protection of multiple airbags, surrounded by 1,000 pounds of steel and seat belts, could possibly cause you, who does have the protection of airbags, seat belts, and steel, to be so physically threatened that you about had to hit the ditch.
You want me to do it?
My
now?
Guess is that from your description, I could probably cite countless issues where you were either not patient enough to pass safely, or you were just inconvenienced too long for your own liking. There are cyclists that break. There are cyclists that break laws in this state.
Robert, that's enough.
I'm going to close with suggestions. Y'all want me to speak?
Yeah!
Yeah. Do y'all yield your 3 minutes?
Yeah, the Marshals do.
I yield my 3 minutes.
I understand. I've got some real suggestions. 30 seconds. 30 seconds?
No.
Okay.
Come on.
The next person.
Guys.
A lot of people here want to speak. Let's let everybody get a chance today.
Sure. Okay. Let me remind everybody.
Want to know?
Yeah, he needs to be escorted.
Okay.
We're here to talk about both sides of the issues. I let him go way past 3 minutes, and I thought, that's my fault. I shouldn't have done that. So,
can you at least answer his question?
Limit your comments to 3 minutes. We have lots of other people that want to speak.
All right, can you answer his question?
Ma'am, if you could be quiet, please. Thank you. I'm trying to be as courteous as I possibly can. And the marshals are here to escort you out. I'm sorry, but we've got to keep order. Thank you.
Yeah.
I want to hear from John Coyle. John's from...
Well, let him answer his question.
No.
We're here for a public hearing. I'm here to hear from you.
I will
be glad to meet with him later on. Mr. John Coyle. I'm sorry? We're trying to keep an orderly meeting. I'm sorry. John's an advocate, bicyclist, grew up here in Gainesville. Good to see you.
Just 1 second, guy. That's very disappointing. Robert's a friend of mine. He sat down, so it's very disappointing that you guys had him escorted out. That's all I'm going to say about it.
Thank you, John. But if you'll go ahead and talk about your 3 minutes, please.
I will.
Thank you. I'm going to call on Dr. Chuck DeArmond to come speak. Dr. DeArmond's a retired educator, and he's probably been cycling 25, 26 years, and Dr. DeArmond, I'm glad you made it. So.
Still short.
Thank you, Carl.
Yeah, I used to have the old spoke and pedal bike shop here in Gainesville a long time ago.
I think this thing might be
a cyclist.
There's more people growing on the other side of what they are. They show up to me where they get out. That's the part.
I don't know.